Oh man, that's why we absolutely hate doing those Starship flying soon videos. Because the flight just keeps getting delayed and delayed. Now some strong winds again pushed back the date for Starship's first 15-kilometer test flight. So let's try to estimate when we can finally see this thing fly.
Then let's talk about the US Space Force again, because it's time to revisit the newest branch of the US military and try to analyze what will happen to it under the new administration. And lastly, you won't believe it, but stacking of the SLS has begun. Yes, after only 10 years of development time, the SLS is finally being prepared for its first launch. Quite some interesting stuff, so stay tuned. Okay, so we have to do a voiceover now for the Starship news part, because that keeps changing 500 times per day, and the stuff we recorded yesterday is now of course totally outdated already. Because yesterday on Sunday, it still looked as if the Starship SN8 15-kilometer flight would take place earliest by the end of the week, possibly as late as next week. But now suddenly things are looking a lot better, and Elon said that they will perform another static fire on Tuesday the 1st of December, and the 15-kilometer flight then earliest on Wednesday the 2nd of December. But we have to say that we have a hard time really believing that it will be already on Wednesday after the so many delays with SN8. I mean, this thing was supposed to fly already back in October, according to Elon, if you remember. So probably towards the end of the week is more realistic. But hey, we could be positively surprised this time, yeah? Who knows? Anyhow, this is the official wording, and we hopefully will find out soon.
Besides Starship SN8, not much has happened at Boca Chica since we made the last update about Starship. So let's talk about Space Force again. We still believe that the creation of the US Space Force was one of Trump's biggest achievements. Now many people will say, but that is very aggressive and militaristic. How can you support something like this, Jixuan and Sebastian? Are you total militaristic berserks? No, but let's look at the aggressive expansionist behavior of China in space. For example, the famous 2007 anti-satellite missile test, where they decided to destroy a Chinese weather satellite with a kinetic projectile, hitting the satellite at over 10 kilometers per second relative speed. This test created about 150,000 pieces of space debris, with most of the debris still orbiting, since it takes quite a long time until space debris re-enters Earth's atmosphere and thus gets destroyed. Or you might also still remember the Russian anti-satellite missile test from April this year. At least, they didn't destroy a satellite. They just tested the missile itself. But still, this shows that the other space powers will not get peaceful and all cozy if the US is peaceful in space. For the sake of completeness, India also conducted an anti-satellite missile test on March 27th. But contrary to China, the test was conducted such that a lot less space debris was created.
In fact, even though anti-satellite missile tests are really not a good thing, the Indian one was in fact the most responsible one to date, since they calculated the probable trajectories beforehand such that the resulting debris would glow up in Earth's atmosphere very fast, which the debris actually did. But many other dangerous space incidents keep happening. For example, in May this year, the core stage of a Chinese Long March 5B rocket re-entered Earth's atmosphere over populated areas in Africa. This incident had Jim Bridenstine get angry, calling it really dangerous. He used it as an example of why the Artemis Accords are necessary to ensure safe operations on the moon. In a statement, he said space exploration should inspire hope and wonder, not fear and danger. And please subscribe to our channel, because as you can see, we are one of the only ones who don't shy away from politics. In fact, we think that space and politics are quite often intertwined. However, we really need your support to continue to grow and expose what's going on in the spaceflight industry and continue saying these inconvenient things. So thank you very much in advance. Really, thank you very much in advance for your support.
Back on topic. Some powers will just keep expanding and aggressively conquering the space domain with military force, or behaving irresponsibly with regard to spaceflight. Thus, it was an absolutely logical and necessary step to create this newest branch of the US Armed Forces. And even though the mainstream media likes nothing more than to bash Trump wherever they can, we will not change our opinion on that here. Trump and Pence was the best administration for space exploration, probably since the days of Kennedy. Not only the creation of the Space Force was very good, but also the aggressive moon return target of 2024 instead of 2028 was excellent. For the first time since the 60s, we had the impression that the American spirit of achieving impossibly hard things in a short amount of time was back. The creation of the Artemis Accords for responsible international cooperation on the moon was also an absolutely well thought out and necessary step. So this administration really did a lot of good for spaceflight. And we are sorry if some people might now feel offended by us saying that.
But I'm not sorry.
But last we heard, there was still something existing called freedom of speech. Although, of course, we all know that platforms like YouTube or Twitter are doing their very best to bury that concept.
Anyways, back on topic before we get carried away again, what is actually the course of the new administration, for example, on Space Force or Artemis? Well, the moon landing will of course get delayed. We talked about that many times in previous videos. So we think the Artemis Accords will probably remain unchanged, even though of course now they won't play a role until 2028 earliest. But on Space Force, it seems that the new administration will stay the course set by Trump and Pence. At least that's what Washington aerospace and defense-focused consulting firm Velos believes. In an email to clients, they recently wrote that Biden has expressed no plans for structural changes to US space programs, and that the Democratic Party national platform supports continuity within NASA and the Space Force. We really hope that Velos is right. Undoing the Space Force would be a grave mistake, and we sincerely hope that the US will stay the course regarding the Space Force, the Artemis Accords, and the return to the moon under the new administration. We shall see, but if not, you can rest assured that we will rant very, very often against the course of the new administration in space matters on this channel here. Very often. And you know what we also like to rant about very often? SLS! Our favorite money pit of human spaceflight. Our favorite government-subsidized jobs creation program. But why are we so critical of SLS, you might ask? I mean, this rocket is not so bad. It has some impressive stats after all. The Block 1 configuration, the base configuration so to speak, has a payload capacity to low Earth orbit of 95 metric tons, which is 31 metric tons more than the current strongest rocket, the Falcon Heavy. Then it can land 26 metric tons on the moon. This is also at least 20 to 30% more than the Falcon Heavy. And since Starship appears to still be a few years away, it's probably the best thing we have right now, right?
Well, it would have been 10 years ago. If now we would have the year 2010, and SLS would be assembled for the first launch in 2010, then we probably would agree. But the problem is that now we have 2020, and reusability is the big thing that is super important. But SLS is not reusable at all. One SLS costs currently around $1 billion per unit, with prices expected to come down to $800 million per unit, but not lower. So the problem with SLS is that this is not sustainable. This is not a way for sustainable exploration of the moon. That is why we need Starship, because Starship will have far more payload capacity to LEO and much more to the moon, and it will be fully reusable. And Starship will only cost $2 million per launch, compared to SLS's insane $800 million to $1 billion per launch. So now you understand why we rant so often about SLS. But at least SLS seems to be going forward. at the pace of a snail, of course, but still going forward. The stacking of the SLS's solid rocket boosters has now begun at Kennedy Space Center. As you can see on these pictures here, the SLS solid rocket boosters are basically a slight upgrade of the old space shuttle boosters. An additional segment has been added, thus increasing the propellant mass, allowing for more thrust. Each SLS booster creates 16 MN of thrust, which is really impressive, compared to the shuttle's 12.45 MN. And as a comparison, Starship will have around 62 MN of thrust, with 28 sea-level Raptor engines on the Super Heavy booster. So at least the solid rocket boosters of SLS are an upgrade, even though it's funny that the development time for that was so insanely long. Anyways, they are being stacked now, and after the booster stacking is complete, the core stage, which is undergoing final green run testing at NASA's Stennis Space Center, will be delivered to the Kennedy Space Center and moved to the Vehicle Assembly Building to continue rocket construction.
And then, if everything goes as planned, we hopefully will be able to witness the launch of the unmanned Artemis 1 mission in November 2021. Even though we're not fans of the SLS, we'll still be happy to see it fly. But let's see for how long it can survive after Starship will become fully functional. We think that once Starship and Super Heavy fly to orbit on a regular basis, the time will have come for SLS to say goodbye, and that probably will be the case in 3 to 4 years, realistically. So, to come back full circle to the beginning of the video, let's hope that Starship progress will speed up a bit, because Starship, we need you! And if you missed our last JS Space report, where we talked about the final preparations of Starship for that 15-kilometer flight, which hopefully is going to happen soon, we talked about it in this video here.
So thanks for watching the JS Space report, and I would say, on to the future!
Wir haben wirklich Spaß!
Now the famous test. Jixuan and Jiba. Oh god, I cannot say my own name. Yes!
Yes, we are!